This is what's called conduction aphasia. Aphasia may also develop very slowly, as in the case of brain tumors or progressive diseases such as Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease. This is a three-dimensional representation of Wernicke's area. That's where you have. As I said, it's associate language comprehension. Without this area, people can hear words or read letters, but have difficulty attributing any meaning to them. In other words, it doesn't make any sense to them. Then you have the Broca's area, and which is associated with speech production. People with damage to this area are unable to produce language properly. They may speak in very disconnected words. They can't really make complete sentences, for example. Why is language mapping so important? When you have any neurologic disease, when you go for neurosurgery, the neurosurgeon has to make sure that he or she does not damage your speech area or language area. So for that person, it's important to know which part is responsible. This part varies from human to human, so you can't really say that I'm going to spare this part because this corresponds to language. There's biological variability. There is WADA test. Again, I don't want to go into what WADA test is, but the point is it's invasive. It involves a lot of opening the brain, so on and so forth. The functional MRI, which is a non-invasive one, now is increasingly used to understand and identify the eloquent areas of which language is one in a non-invasive way. And this is, I'll show you again, this one, for example, here. This is the motor cortex, which is responsible for your movements. You move your hand or talk, move your mouth or leg, whatever that is. That is the motor cortex. And that is Broca's area, that's Wernicke's area, and this is arcuate vesicles, which comes in. Based on advanced MRI, what we call the diffusion tensor imaging, people have found this bundle only in humans, not in animals. Consistent with the fact that only humans have the ability to speak and comprehend language. What is magnetic resonance imaging and where exactly does it fit into the whole equation? It's a modality for visualizing internal parts of the body non-invasively without really opening up any of the parts of the body. Since its introduction about 30 years ago, MRI has become the radiologic modality of choice for visualizing various diseases, such as tumors. You must have heard the word MRI, go for MRI test. That's what basically what we are doing. We are trying to visualize what's going on. In the last 20 years, there are tremendous developments in this area to understand brain functioning. In other words, now we are not just looking at the brain, but we're able to read the mind. So what we call the mind imaging, which is very different from brain. Brain imaging basically looks at different anatomical parts, but mind tells you how you think, how you talk, how you scheme, so on and so forth. It's increasingly used to understand working of brain, as I said, to read the mind. The MRI scan is nothing but consists of large, powerful magnets to accommodate humans, and it uses radio waves. These are the same waves that you use for FM and TV transmission. That's all what it is. And therefore, they're considered to be safe. And it's fairly expensive to purchase and maintain. A typical MRI scanner, for example, could cost you anywhere between $3 million, which translates into about 15 crores. That's only part of the story. To maintain that one, again, you spend about 1 to 2 crores every year just to keep it maintained. It requires special room for housing. And for example, here I showed you, they're trying to prepare this site for putting the magnet. You put a lot of steel beams or steel plates here, and carefully, one by one, they weld in place. And once you prepare this one, this is how the naked MRI room looks. A lot of shielding, what we call the shield, which consists of 2 to 6 inch thick steel plates. And this was one of the first MRI scanners built in Hammersmith in England. And this is a modern 3 Tesla scanner. In our body, you can see how polished the modern one looks. We say the old one, where that's where the human was lying. Perhaps take a ladder and get into this one. Whereas here a table and everything which moves the subject in the center of the magnet. And the original Hammersmith image of brain, that's what it looks. And it took about 6 to 7 hours to generate this image. And still it's not very clear. This image, for example, modern scanners, you generate in about 2 to 3 minutes. And look at the details. You are seeing the cerebrospinal fluid. And you have the gray matter. That's what I have shown you before. And the white matter, which is dark. And this is some pathology that we see in the brain. You know, in the last 30 years, we came a real long, long way in terms of the technology. If you look at the MRI of the brain, this is an MRI image in 3 dimensions of the surface of the brain. This is the gray matter. Again, you see the sulcal patterns, which are deep convolutions, and the gyral patterns, which are elevated. This is where all the action generates. This basically is what we call the cortex of the brain or the gray matter. There's a technique called functional MRI. Again, I don't want to go into the physics of MRI. What it does is, let's say that I move my fingers. Because this certain part of the brain controls, what you see is the motor cortex, which is responsible for the movement of the fingers, is what actually activates. And you see a signal from that one. That's how you can give different tasks, either moving, or for example, you can blow hot air to look at the sensory component. So if you look at that one, here the person actually is moving left hand, it's a left hand patient, and the right, you see the activation, which is shown in red, yellow, you activate on the predominantly on the right side. So this is what we call the contralateral activation. The left part of the brain actually controls the right part. And again, if I look at different movements, for example, foot, hand, lip, tongue, these are the areas, for example, that are activated. For example, blue, if I move the foot, that part of the brain, motor cortex is activated. And if I move the hand, this part is activated. And if I move the lip as I talk, that part, the orange, is what's activated. And if I move my tongue, I mean, like, for example, or to swallow the food, then the tongue actually is that part of the motor cortex actually. If you look at what we know from previous lot of invasive studies, you notice that the functional MRI actually corresponds exactly to the same regions what scientists have attributed earlier. As I said, if I activate the finger tapping, this is the region we actually mainly activate. You can show it in 3 dimensions so that we understand exactly in a 3 dimension which part of the brain is activated. That gives a very good representation for the clinicians to treat the patients. This many times what we used to do is, in order to do the neurosurgical planning, we used to generate the MR outside and then give those pictures to the physician, neurosurgeon, and neurosurgeon has another apparatus, and then we used to correlate which part of the brain should be avoided. Now there's a new technology emerging, what is called intraoperative MRI, where actually the MRI is located in the operating theater, and the patient lies, and the surgeon in the real time can map which part of the brain actually is responsible and avoid damages to that part of the brain because of neurosurgical procedures. And here is where the surgeons actually are preparing. The patient is put inside, and surgeons do whatever surgical procedures need to be done, and the images actually are flashed in real time on the screen right there. And the white matter, again, using diffusion intensity imaging, you can actually see which part of the brain connects which part of the cortex. These are the spinal cord, what called spinal cord tracts, which are responsible for much of the movement and sensory feelings, so on and so forth. If we look at the DTI, remember that I said arcuate fasciculus is a white matter bundle which connects the Wernicke's area and the Broca's area. Now actually you can see that bundle right there connecting those two areas. And when we look at the speech between males and females, for males most of the speech or language is localized to the left hand side of the brain. Left corresponds, L corresponds left, R comes right. In contrast, if you look at the females, both right and left hand brains are activated. What it's telling is that females, they use their brains more wisely than men. And they're also very soft. That's why the son, the child, always go to the mama and never to the papa. So this is one of the reasons. It's pretty interesting to see the gender differences in the language. So now let's look at, you speak the words and hear the words. And see, in other words, you write the word, let the person speak. And let the person hear the word and let the person speak. How does it take? How does it happen? For example, let's say that to speak a word that's read, information first must go to visual cortex. Remember what I said? The primary visual cortex is the occipital lobe in the back of the brain. That's what is first activated. From the primary visual cortex, information is transmitted to the speech area, in this case, vernix area, right? That's where it goes. So information goes from here and flows through that one. How does it flow? It flows through the white matter bundles. Remember the cables I was talking about, are the wires. Then vernix area transmits that information to Broca's area so that you can interpret what the person said. And now, if you want to say that word, then Broca's area communicates with the primary motor cortex. Why? Because when you want to speak, you have to move your lips. So now you have the circuit from seeing to language language area, comprehending area, and then to the motor cortex. Now let's say that we see the person actually hears the word, not writing, not seeing the word, but hears the word. How does it communicate now? To speak out that said information must first go to the primary auditory cortex, that means which controls our hearing. This is the primary auditory cortex right there. From this cortex, the information is transmitted to the posterior speech area, including vernix area right there. From the vernix area, it actually goes back to the Broca's area, which has to comprehend, and then goes to the primary motor cortex to speak the word, because again, you have to move your lips. So notice how beautifully the information is flowing from one part of the brain, which specializes, effectively communicating to the axons and dendrites of the nerve cell, and then goes to whatever motor area, whatever area that needs to for it to go. And again, there's very interesting thing. For example, here on the left-hand side, I show you what are the areas that are activated when you move the foot, for example, blue. That's why actually when you move the foot, that part of the brain is activated. And we use finger movement. This is the part, the orange part is what's activated. And when you use the tongue, it is the green part which is activated. Now let's say that I talk the word. Now what I do is, I use the leg-related word. For example, I say foot. If you look at that one, when you look at the area, that area basically corresponds to leg movement. So even though you're not moving the leg, the fact that you are talking about the foot, basically automatically the brain can interpret the context in which the statement is made, and basically it activates only that particular area. Similarly, when you talk about hand, let's say fingers, suddenly you see only that particular area to be activated. So in other words, the brain can understand the context in which you are talking and communicate that information within the brain, and that results in action, whatever the action might be. With the technical, how does the brain and language develop? With technological breakthroughs such as MRI, we can follow what occurs in the development of language. For example, each child has more than about 550,000 nerve pathways that can carry sounds from human voice from ears to brain. Brain encodes words actually and rearranges its brain cells into connections or networks to produce language. I'll come to that in a minute. Between the ages 4 and 12, enormous amount of brain reconstruction takes place. If child is receiving rich sensory stimulation, the surge of learning takes place. Let me give you a concrete example. Most of you wonder why babies are good at learning language. Whereas as adults, we have very difficult task in learning any foreign language. Can I have some water, please? If you set language, the brain strengthens connections corresponding to that particular language. In other words, you are already hardwiring the brain to understand your native language. The connections for other brain languages become weaker and may eventually wither or disappear. When we try to learn a foreign language as adults, we must fit new sounds into the language connections that are already made. In other words, it's like taking the brick, clay, and putting in the fire, where actually it becomes rigid. You can't change anymore. You can't shape it. Exactly the same thing happens. By adulthood, most people have trouble in distinguishing sounds that are not in their language. For example, if you take Japanese language, you cannot really distinguish the sound R from L. So if you go to a Japanese person and talk load, then he thinks that you are saying road. Or if you say road, he thinks that you are talking load. So Japanese, they do not have the ability to distinguish L and R. Therefore, if you, as a child, if you learn Japanese, when you become adult, it becomes very difficult for you to distinguish these sounds. But on the other hand, as a child, you can easily distinguish. That's when you are a child, you can distinguish different languages. As adults, we talk to babies. When we talk to babies, notice we talk very slowly and we talk very repetitively. We say the same word again and again. What this does is we talk more slowly, raise the pitch of our voice, and exaggerate the accent in our words. Okay? These changes make it easier for babies to hear our language and recognize the patterns of our words. Even children as young as 4 years will make some of these changes in their speech when talking to a baby. For example, if you take a 4-year-old son and talk to a baby, notice that the way the child talks to you as a parent is quite different from the way he or she talks to a child. Or child talks very slowly in a very fun way. As adults, we also tend to repeat words and phrases when we talk to babies. Repetition helps babies learn, understand speech, and strengthen the language connections. Remember, all these things are connections because it's really programming how the brain communicates with each part of the other part of the brain. So these are the connections which are responsible, which strengthen at different times. It's a very interesting study that was done. What they have done was they compared two adults. One is a monolingual, and another is a bilingual. They want to see which part of the brain actually is how the brain reacts for these things. So what I'm showing in yellow is if I take a monolingual and I look at the bilingual, the area that is shown in yellow has a larger volume or larger gray matter or more gray matter in bilinguals compared to monolinguals. The same size in different planes. This is what we call the sagittal plane, this coronal lecture. Here is the interesting thing. If you look at how much gray matter is increased in this bilingual, depending on the proficiency in the second language, if the person is very proficient in second language, you notice that the gray matter volume is much higher in that area, which actually controls the language. And similarly, if I look at age of acquisition of the second language and try to see how this gray matter actually increases, you notice that as the age of acquisition increases, that means as an adult, if you try to pick up a second language, the brain really is not really changing that much. The gray matter hasn't really increased that much. On the other hand, if you try to pick up second language very early on in life, let's say less than 5 years, then you see that that gray matter or that brain area has the strongest connection and highest density, which is telling us that it's like almost like building body. You do more exercise, you build up your muscles. This is an exercise of the brain where you tend to learn the second language, basically strengthen the muscles in the brain, so to speak. What are the do's and don'ts when you do it? Talk to young children, language is symbolic and requires thinking just to unlock meaning of words. So you need to give chance for the child to understand. use of audio tapes frequently to replace videos or movies for entertainment, this is not good. Because when you look at videos, you are not really giving the child enough time to think, because video is there. On the other hand, if you talk, the child has to understand, analyze, and strengthen the brain. Fast-moving screen images require little thought to process and don't give much time to the cerebral cortex to engage and therefore to develop. Limit the use of television. TV is not very symbolic and usually requires few mental gymnastics to interpret. That means you are not allowing your child's brain to develop by letting the child watch too much of TV at the young age. Introduce another language. In this age of fanaticism, where we think that our language is the greatest and discourage people from learning second language, we are making one of the greatest blunders. Teach the child early on to speak a second language. Learning a new language becomes more difficult after age 12, when the brain's maps have become more rigid, just like brick. You really cannot mold it anymore the way you mold the clay. Involve children in discussions and dialogues as everyday part of life. Questions such as, what do you think? How do you see this? What might happen? These questions help young people to listen, process, and develop their minds, which is extremely important. What I do is, instead of prolonging the agony, I think probably I best stop it here and let you ask questions or engage me in discussion. Thank you very much for your attention.